All right. We are recording on both. I think I'm in focus. Let me double check that. Sorry, guys. Got to look at just me for a quick second.
Is that purple?
Yeah. You like it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Because, like, I use the blue on the accent.
Well, it lights up your carp, your ground.
And then the purple on... Oh yeah, because you're looking on that camera and thinking about this one. But yeah, it lights everything up quite nice. Here, have I shown you the?
Yeah.
See it? Oh, okay, I didn't remember if I'd shown you.
I shaved since last time. My trim.
Yeah. I had to cancel my hair and beard trim. Anyways, I don't think everyone wants to listen to us talk about our facial hair. So, guys, welcome to Anime Versal Reviews podcast here on the Genreverse Podcast Network and YouTube channel. So hit that red subscribe button. Hit the follow button if you're listening on audio, all that good stuff. I'm Kyle. That's Brian. For those that are review watchers only and don't watch our reactions, Christine is not here. Obviously, she is recovering from her second bout of COVID. And what's funny is the first time we all had it go through the house was last August. And here we are this September. And this time it seems Lucas brought it home from school despite testing negative. We're pretty certain it was just a false negative because, I mean, it's the same as what she has, and he was sick first. So I remain either asymptomatic or not infected. Yeah. No idea. You know, I don't want to get into a discussion about the vaccines and things. We had vaccines and got it. I had the vaccine before getting it. Christine got it and then got the vaccine, and then she got it again. And it is what it is. We are all okay. It hit Christine a little bit harder than it hit Lucas, which seems to be par for course for everyone. That young kids seem to be for the most part better off. And I, like I said, remain mostly either asymptomatic. I had like a throat tickle for a few hours one night, and then I had some minor headaches, but I never had any cough, any sniffles, anything else. So thanks to everyone on the reaction side who sent well wishes to Christine and our son. And yeah, man, I'm ready to talk about this because I've had no one to talk about this with other than some of the people in the comments. Classroom of the Elite Season 2, Episode 12, the penultimate episode for this Season 2. And Brian, spoiler-free thoughts, man, since nobody's heard your thoughts at all yet.
This is, dude. You know me. This was everything I wanted it to be. I was smiling ear to ear. I watched it right before I had to go to work, and I was pumped for work. I was just like, yeah.
Hold on. This, like, who were you wanting to beat up at work?
it's just that kind of episode, you know, where you're just like, I'm ready to get this day going, you know. It, because it wasn't, like I said, we're not going to spoil anything here, but it wasn't just the action, if you will, that occurred. It was all the politics and all the seeds that have been laid, all finally all connected. And you know, I was just like, oh,
the connections. I love it when that happens. And again, without getting into too many spoilers yet, dude, this was tense. Like, there's a moment where I'm like, oh my god, will this even stop? Like, I had that moment of doubt, like, will it go too far? The title of our my reaction video. I'm taking all the credit for that. Thanks to everyone that did subscribe. Helped us break 500. We're at 531 as of this recording, so thank you guys for that. It was so intense, and so many man, the animation budget, I think a lot of that went into these last few episodes. I think the voice actors, I think the just everything, man. This felt amazing, even though, like I said, there were moments where it was just like super uncomfortable, but in the best way, if that makes sense. Did you have discomfort watching this, Brian? Like
more last week, honestly. I thought, especially the last 5 minutes.
Yeah.
Definitely this. But like I said, this, without spoiling it, it answered so many things, and it was done so beautifully, and it was the kind of episode, you know, it was that payoff episode where you're like, oh, if you've been watching and paying attention for, you know, all through the series, mm-hmm. this episode, it was for you, you know, it was good.
Which makes me think, you know, will this be a lot like the final episode of Stone Wars, where it's more like a prologue?
I was thinking before, the same,
you know, exact I'm thinking thing, yeah. Maybe this will be more like a pro, because like legit, even if this had been the last episode,
perfect,
it would have been fine.
Yeah, absolutely.
I'm ready for the next one, but this would have been an interesting way to wrap up season two. So
this in many ways wrapped up this arc, if you will. And like you said, maybe the next episode will set up what's coming.
Hopefully. So, Brian, here's the big question. Is this an A+?
This is an A+.
I gave it an A+ too. Yeah. I was quite happy with it. We'll talk a little bit more about the animation and things like that as we get into our spoilers, but I think I think each of us gave maybe two episodes A+ this season. I know you gave one other A+, yeah, I did. Right?
At least one or two others. Yeah.
Yeah. It's great, man. It really is. So you ready to talk some spoilers for this stuff?
Yes.
Okay. So I broke it down on my timestamps to go over Ryuen talking to Kay first, Karyazawa. Then we'll talk about Ayanokoji spilling his own beans, and then we'll get into the fight, and then we'll talk about the meaning of fear, and then Karyazawa K's growth towards the end. So, dude, opening up with you know, continuing on the Ryuen and Karyazawa situation, great. We get some more of that discomfort with the water and everything like that. But dude just straight up outs Ayanokoji, puts all sorts of doubt into her mind, and I loved it. I loved every moment of it. Like, it was mental anguish, it was physical anguish, it was a test to so much. What thoughts were going through your mind as he's like revealing to her she's been a pawn in Ayanokoji's plan the whole time.
Right up to the point. I mean, I assumed she was gonna, you know, spill the information, she was gonna give up, which would have been fine.
Oh, you thought she was gonna, okay,
and
okay.
I would have been fine with it. And that moment when she's like, no, screw you, you know, I was like, oh my god. Yeah, that was shocking. But just, I was curious to how far, I mean, because they were basically saying, oh, he's gonna get her to like leave. But with the torture mm-hmm. stuff, I'm like, how far is this going to go?
Yeah.
You know, that was something I was like, wow. You know.
I even asked that during the reaction, like, how far is he? Like, what does destroy yeah. to him mean? Is it just release the information about the fake boyfriend and the past bullying? Or is it, I will beat the, you know, like, how far was Ryuen willing to go? And man, I'll tell you what, I think he was willing to go quite far. I honestly didn't know whether or not she would spill the beans. When she started questioning it, and this will get into some of her growth later in the discussion, but you know, she rationalizes not telling him. You know, she kind of, you kind of see where some of the things she's been through with Ayanokoji kind of help make her mature, you know, grow a little bit to where her priorities are different, and for mostly a good way. And while I still don't necessarily think Kiyotaka, did I say it right? Ayanokoji while I don't think his ends or his means will still necessarily justify his or his ends justify his means, Jesus. I do get where people are like, oh, he's helping people. Yeah, but they didn't, did they need it that way? I mean, geez, I really wondered how long it would. I wondered last week, you know, is he going to walk with his group in a certain way to, you know, show up and rescue her that way? Like, that was one of my biggest questions, was how does he protect her from, you know, does he keep that promise? Cause I hate to constantly bring up Senku and company over at Dr. Stone, but that was a big freaking deal. Tsukasa breaking his promise, which was very, very similar, you know, from this moment forward, I'll do the fighting. No harm will come to you guys. And here's Ayanokoji. You know, he's willing to let her suffer a bit, but I was getting nervous.
You do ask the question, especially by the end, when, if you really examine it, it's like, did he need to let her get tortured at all? Mm. The only thing that that did was sort of show him her resiliency.
And her resilience, her,
you know, loyalty. Besides yes. that, he could have been, if you think about it, he could have walked in right behind them as they went in there and did what he did.
Same results.
Yeah. You know what I mean? There was nothing that really happened.
I think maybe even giving Ryuen the taste of victory, like,
well, if it was a mind
thinking
game,
he was getting close to maybe I mean, everything he does is with a purpose, and it even makes the end of this episode, while still somewhat relieving, still questionable, where you're just like, I don't, like, I trust you, but I don't trust you to, let you know, protect her 100%, you know, she'll just get roughed up enough. Have the boots put to her medium style. That's what Ayanokoji seems to be wanting to allow. Him coming up with his plan to get in, going to the teacher, saying, "Hey, you know, you could help out," and her being like, "Well, here's the thing, us teachers don't give to, you know, flying fracks about you guys unless there's something in it for us. So I really don't see what's in it for me anymore after, you know, my last trump card failed." But he still manages to pique her interest enough to get her out there and say, "Look, here's my other eyes," which I'm guessing Horikita's brother is just there to witness Ayanokoji being attacked and defending himself, you know, because he's like, "I'm just here to witness and be a part for the aftermath." It's a really cool plan to bring someone else in. And the other thing that kind of happens in that conversation is the brother being like, you know, you'll help me push Horikita towards the student council. So, I mean, he's a caring brother in a way. I mean, just a complete ass in how he shows it. What do you think about Ayanokoji's plan and that interaction with bro?
It's interesting how much Horikita's been sidelined up sort of in the last, you know,
few episodes. Yeah.
But this sort of shows that no, she's still part of the, you know, part of the story. The plan was interesting. I whenever her brother pops up, I'm just like, oh, what's he doing? Even the teacher was surprised, like, oh, what's he got going on? Yeah. So, you know, that was interesting. But just to see how, you know, last week, that was one of my things. I was like, you know, it felt like he had no plan or wasn't even aware of what was going on. But the fact that everything was planned for such a long time, he knew exactly what was going to happen when, and this all fell into his plan.
He needed to make sure that he impressed the brother enough, piqued the brother's interest enough to make sure he was in position if and when he needed him.
Still curious about the new president.
Yeah, and what you know, where their loyalties lie and things like that. If they're as gung-ho about this Hunger Games as everyone else seems to be. I guess I forgot that the black student is American, I'm guessing, because he speaks English to him. I'm not sure if we missed something on that, but it was an interesting moment. It just kind of threw me for a loop because I couldn't remember clearly why Ayanokoji would speak English to him. But he walks in, and I'll be honest with you, man, the last thing I expected was him to say, I'm the mastermind, bitch. Like, I didn't see that coming.
It wasn't just that it's me and this is how I operate.
Yeah.
You're gonna do
not just I'm the mastermind, but by the way, this is how much of a mastermind I am, and I'm still not telling you.
Remember that everything. Camera? Yeah, I effed up your camera.
Let's go back to season one. I mean, holy, been playing holy crap, you all. Man. I thought he was just gonna find some creative way, you know. Look, Karyazawa emailed me. She needs help. I'm here. What's going on? You know, I didn't. But what a way to do it. And then when you see what he's trying to do, what weapon he's trying to use against Ryuen, it's just
well, just his understanding of Ryuen's psyche, that, you know, yes, the only thing he understands is violence, is fear, and so he has to build this game in order to show him, when it comes to violence, I'm the man.
I'm
when it comes to fear, I'm the man. You know, man, and when you realize that he's been sort of collecting this information, understanding what kind of person he is, and how do you defeat someone like that?
Mm-hmm.
Oh my god.
Someone, I'm looking for the who told me. I'm sorry, guys. I don't want to spend too much time flipping through here, but over on the AVR Squared video, talking about the weapons, you know, Ryuen's constantly saying, you know, violence is the most powerful weapon. They reminded us that back in episode 9, Ayanokoji basically tells Ryuen, I'll meet you in whatever arena you choose. Ryuen chose violence, and Ayanokoji still just throwing it down, man. It was intense because the whole thing comes to fear and you know, the fact that Ryuen hasn't had something to fear in a while, but still has the capacity to fear, and he needed to remind him of that. And boy, does he remind him of it. You ready to talk about the fight?
Amen.
Okay, so this fight, besides one helping eat up some of that budget, I noticed a few things about it. The animation is great. I love the use of not just the shadow, but the light being blinding in a way, the spotlights, the construction lights especially. I like it because, one, it makes you uncomfortable, makes you feel some of what the people there in the arena are feeling. It makes you appreciate the shadow. It makes you appreciate what you can see. It's different because so many light is just that thing that so many people take for granted, and in these situations shadow plays up so much more. And while this was used to accent the shadows, I think they went in with a purpose with some of this lighting. The animation is great. There's so many things, not just in the fight itself, but even before and after. There's the scene towards the end where the shadow and the light bisects Ayanokoji's face perfectly as he's stuck in a K. It was an intense, like I mentioned in my reaction, that one, he squares up against all of them differently.
Yes.
Like he knows multiple fighting styles.
Yes,
yeah. I was like, that was one of the first thing, you know, the first thing, it's like, okay, you're grappling. That makes sense. Dude moved in close. Ayanokoji handled it close. And then he squares up with a guy that's obviously a brawler boxer type and plays that game, and then the next person's throwing MMA stuff. So Ayanokoji just smoothly moves into all of that. And the other thing I mentioned was that he kept each fight short. And I said, part of that, I said, I don't know if they did this, but in reality, anybody that's ever trained to fight, and I said, at pro levels, I understand there's a bit of showmanship, but still you don't want to be in a fight longer than necessary, because the longer a fight goes on, the higher the risk of you losing, and greater injuries come due to people being tired, not executing moves appropriately. And I said, it goes back to like even hand-to-hand combat training in the military. You end the fight as quickly as possible. The longer it goes on, the worse. And that's what he did. He just squared up long enough to figure out, okay, I only need three moves to mate with this person. Haha, that's a chess joke, guys. But I only need to do this because of the way that they're fighting. And then he executes it, and that's the end of it. You know, I mean, hell, the girl at the end, apparently in the light novel, he mentions like scoping an upskirt shot because he feels no threat to her and takes her down real quick and easy like that. And they cut that out of the anime. But even with her, he takes her down so quick, so fast, helps her down like, okay, mm-hmm. Next. What you talk?
No, like you said, he clearly knows multiple styles. He that goes back all the way to when he encountered the brother, mm-hmm. when he was trying to decipher like what is your style.
Yeah.
You know, so we got a little tape. We knew he knew how to fight, but we didn't know all the details that we do now. He knows, yeah. And he we even got some of his inner thoughts on analyzing like Ryuen's style is street brawler, mm-hmm. not a, you know, organized discipline. So
he's not trained.
He yeah. knows, okay, well then this is how he's going to fight. And he, you know, he's working out, okay, well, what do I got to do to adapt? And he clearly did, but yeah, it was like you said, he adapted to everyone's style and he was putting them down as quickly as possible. He wasn't trying to prolong anything. He wanted to make mm-hmm. it clear to each person who came at him, you can't beat me, don't try. Yeah. And the movements were, I mean, the, like you said, the animation, clearly there was a lot more budget in this one, because just some of the hits, I was just like, woo. I mean, it was nice to watch. But yeah,
I like how and I honestly, because you see Kay over off the side, they show her a few times watching this, and there's moments
yeah.
there's moments where I feel she's both in awe yeah. of Ayanokoji, but I also think there's a few moments where, and not just when he's beating the shit out of Ryuen, but even before then, when he's just moving that hard, that fast, I think he scared her.
Yes.
Real quick, go ahead.
The Ryuen, the punching. Oh. Did you notice it wasn't over dramatic? He was applying just the amount of pressure mm-hmm. to cause just the right amount of damage.
Everything was purposeful.
Yeah.
And even when he is looks like, you know, he is getting beat up, he's blocking shots, and you can see the hand moving and blocking shot, but real close, you know, so that way it still looks like he's getting hit. And I wondered if he was playing that up for Kariyazawa, like, look, I am in danger. I can be hurt. You know, was he playing that up to her, blocking them so close and so? It still looked like he was getting hit if you didn't notice that. So I did wonder about that. God, man, how like so cool, and it went on for a while too. But they had appropriate breaks in there. You know, they would throw down for a while, Ryuen yeah. losing it as the fight goes on. He's absolutely starting to lose his cool. Even when he starts giving his big villain speech, where he thinks he has the upper hand psychologically, and I love Ayanokoji telling, dude, you never had a moment where you were in control. You yeah. never had a moment. It's such a good fight, and it brings up to that final thing about fear. And that's, you know, when he's towering, oh, well, not just towering, but, you know, on top of Ayanokoji's on top of Ryuen, just beating the crap out of him. And Ryuen's talking about fear. Oh yeah. You know, you'll, now that, I know you're secret and stuff. I'll always be waiting to strike at you. You'll never have any peace or anything like that. And Ayanokoji's like, fear? What fear? Like, and then I even like it when he's like, anger? I'm not angry. Like, or, dude, it, I
that was
nothing. You
that was the disturbing part of the punches into the face is like you said. You know, we've all been in fights. There's anger. There's different emotions for whatever reason, depending on the situation. The fact that he's so calculated, this was not anything done out of spite or out of anger or frustration. This was a tedious task.
I think that's how he said it.
This was a calculated task that needed to be done, and he was doing it.
Yeah.
And to look at a fight like that is crazy. Interesting.
Yeah.
But it's wow.
Yeah. To say the least, I got uncomfortable, man. When he kept hitting, I was like, is he so outwardly stoic that we could be missing some emotion? Are we seeing him potentially letting things out without, you know, visibly letting them out? And I did, man. There's times where I'm like, dude, stop hitting him. You're going to go to jail.
They all technically, you know, they Ryu and they all should probably go to jail for the offense easily, of this evening. Yeah.
Easily. But it made me uncomfortable because look, he's the protagonist of the show, but he's no hero. And I got it, guys. He's done a lot to help Horikita, who's suffered the least amount of damage getting to where she is via Ayanokoji. But he is not a good guy, you know. Even the best intentions done about wrong is still bad things, you know what I'm saying. I don't know, I can't say I've never, but it's been a while since I've gotten that from this type of anime. Like the last time I think I felt this kind of discomfort was Mieroko-chan.
Yeah,
like there were just moments there where you're just uncomfortable, like everything going on is just wrong, and everything going on in that moment, as badass as it was wrong. I think that's what made it so weird to me. But God was it cool. I love that. No fear. No, I almost half expected Ryuen to beg for God's mercy and Ayanokoji to be like, no God, just me. Oh man. Kay's growth. What about her, man? She stuck this shit out to the end, dude. Yeah. She stuck it out. She backed the Ayanokoji boat without knowing whether or not what would be the result of that. I like that she's accepted that he was a dick. How she moves on from here, man. What do you see and what do you think?
I like that when asked why she did what she did, she said it was for her.
Yeah,
you know, so that was interesting. It was more of a, I don't know, it wasn't like, oh, just to help you, you know. So, yeah. Like you said, there is a lot of character growth. This is someone who's finding their way, finding their strength, realizing how resilient, you know,
she can be.
And now I think, you know, there's a bond between these two that's very strong now. Stronger than his and the one with Horikita. Like, I think, I mean, you can't go through what they just
look. I'm not denying her connection to him. It's his to her. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, like, yeah.
I agree. I mentioned how happy she was doing things with him for him. She was getting to be more of who she wanted to be, even if it was in secret, you know, before she's either alone or putting on a face. Here she's either working with Ayanokoji, where she's herself, or putting on the face. But the face was coming off as time went on. You know, she was kind of, you know, relaxing a bit, so to speak. It's still like, dude, couldn't you have found a different way to help her.
This had to be this way. Because
this is brutal. I do appreciate him rededicating the promise of, hey, you know, I won't let you get hurt. You know, I'll protect you on that. But it's how much will she have to suffer before he steps in? He's made it clear he's willing to do that. My question is this, Brian, is even if it's just on the level of respecting their abilities and their capabilities, does it right now make sense to you for her to be that attached to him, that dedicated to him, even on just the respect for his, lack of a better word, game?
I mean, I don't know. It I mean, based on the environment they're in, maybe. I mean, she's definitely at the moment, at the very end of the episode, after everything she witnessed, after everything he says to her afterwards, she is definitely openly committed to being a soldier in his army, you know, and if you put it that way, loyal. And yeah, he seems to realize that. It's like, all right.
Cool. Any other thoughts on this episode, man?
It's great. Like you said, this could have been the finale of the season. I would have been fine with that. Interested to see how they wrap it up, but
yeah, so am I. I had an idea to bring about a team. No, I'm joking. Man, do you miss when Marvel was good? Anyways, guys, Marvel Multiverse Mayhem, if you want to hear me just crap on Marvel for 30 minutes and watch poor Nick just like not know what to do. So we got the final episode coming up next week. Brian, is there a chance that we could work with your schedule and do this live next week instead of recording it?
I don't know.
You don't know?
I'd have to check. Okay. Maybe.
Yeah. Let us know, because I would be interested in potentially doing something like that. We will have reaction videos, guys, for Chainsaw Man coming up, for Spy Family coming up, including potentially with the dude right there, yes. Brian doing the Spy Family.
Spy Family, yes.
Don't know. It kind of really depends on the schedule. For Chainsaw Man. When does it drop and all that? But we will be working that out. So look forward to AVR Squared with Brian in the future. And of course, AVR here, all the reviews will still happen on this show. And Christine and I are always looking for something else to watch. Violet Evergarden broke us hard.
Yeah, you texted me about that.
I can actually see where people are having a hard time watching us watch that, because there's a part where it breaks and you can just watch people start nope, and then that the rest of that gets skipped and they come right back over. So if you are a glutton for emotional punishment, check out our Violet Evergarden reactions. But yeah, lots of content. Make some suggestions, guys. We're always down for more things. I'm trying to drag Brian deeper and deeper into this anime well, but he's being resistant, like a stubborn, I don't know, an asshole. Anyways, I'm joking. Do need to get him to watch 86, though. Desperately need him to watch. To watch 86.
I also enjoy live action stuff.
I don't get that. I just don't. It makes no sense. Anyways, guys, so that's some of the stuff coming up on AVR and AVR Squared. We also have a lot of other content here on the YouTube channel and on the wherever you get your podcast from. Daily Cup of Genre is not really daily, but we're working on it. We do everything in entertainment news, whatever Manny and I want to talk about. Breaking Geek Radio is similar, but it's a whole different group of guys. It's the one and only thing that you'd never see my face on. I produce their show. Jonesy, Nick, Danny, and Jammer are all part of that. I produce it, pop in audio every now and then just to feed info or make a comment whenever Jammer says something stupid like The Last Jedi is the best Star Wars movie. I got to just jump in there. Threaten to fire them as... No, I'm joking. But we also have Marvel Multiverse Mayhem doing She-Hulk reviews. And in between movies and shows, we do news. Nick is trying to get us to watch Morbius. It's not happening. Not.
Is it streaming somewhere?
Somewhere. Netflix, I think.
Is it?
I think so.
I don't know.
Anyways, we've also got the Cantina, which will be starting Andor this week. So that's pretty cool. And then what am I? Review of the Ring. So if you're watching The Rings of Power, you've got me, who's I've read the original books all once. I've read The Hobbit and The Lord of the Rings once back in middle school. But a relative fan of the movies and have perused the appendices, Silmarillion, and some of the other texts and a few wiki pages. So, but then you've got Cam, who is like the historian for Middle Earth and all of that. So Cam is walking us through bouncing things off of what is canon according to Tolkien versus what they're doing here. But he doesn't spoil things beyond where the series is at or what you've seen in Lord of the Rings, like Isildur being there. Like if you didn't pay attention to the name in the movies or the books, you're missing out on a lot there. But other than some things like that, check it out. I can't think if I'm... I don't think I'm missing anything else. We distribute through Sounder now, available wherever you get your podcasts from. And then, Brian, tell them about your channel.
It's called Pulp Mythos. We usually talk about more obscure shows. We're on a little bit of a break. We'll be kicking back off in about 2 weeks when October starts. Nice. So check it out.
Nice. All right, guys. LRMonline.com every day for all your entertainment news needs and opinions. The LRM YouTube channel has all of our celebrity interviews. We got people going to red carpet events, conventions, all sorts of great things, written articles and reviews, news, leaks, rumors, all that stuff goes up there. I guess that's it, guys. It's been a lot of fun. We'll keep you posted about the format for next week, and bye.